Welcome to the Innovation and Technology Management Seminar Series hosted by the Engineering Management Program in the Pratt School of Engineering at Duke University. My name is Jeff Glass and I'm the Faculty Director for the Engineering Management Program. The purpose of our seminar series is to introduce engineers and scientists to various business and management concepts that they will find useful throughout their careers. Speakers represent a diverse array of industries from finance and information technology to materials processing and biotechnology. If you'd like to learn more about the Engineering Management Program at Duke, including these podcasts and any associated audiovisual materials that are sometimes available, please visit our website at memp.duke.edu. Thanks for your interest in our series, and please do not hesitate to contact us with suggestions or questions.
I have to say, I am very impressed on the turnout for Friday at 4 o'clock. But I am a little disappointed that nobody brought their parents. Come on, it's Parents Weekend. I mean, who would not want to come to a lecture on cloud computing on a Friday afternoon? Thanks for having me. I have a lot of content. You know, I could talk for hours on this topic. Nobody really wants that. But I do want to make sure that this is interactive. This is a classroom. This isn't just, you know, me getting up here talking. So I can go at whatever pace. If there are questions that you all have that you want to get answered, if it's brief, I can answer it. If not, you can always, you know, tweet or private tweet me, and I can follow up with you offline. I want to make sure you also, I'm going to try to keep this to the spirit of the class, in that I know from a career perspective you may have questions about, you know, how cloud may play in career planning, or so if I don't address some of those kinds of questions you might have in your mind, feel free to raise your hand and ask questions. The presentation starts with a overview, because I did not know what the level of, you know, knowledge is of cloud. It starts with an overview of cloud computing, and how long we spend in that first part really depends on how well you as a class do on this little pop quiz. So, you know, I ask of you first, describe to me what makes cloud computing unique. What do you know about cloud computing? Just shout out or raise your hand. Wow. Yes?
Offering things as a service. It could be software as a service or something else as a service.
What do you mean by as a service?
As you don't buy the entire thing and you don't download it, but you use it when you want to use it from something like a virtual server, which is a cloud.
Okay. So, you know, one property you mentioned was you get it over a network, right? And what are some other properties of an as-a-service back there?
So basically, an interesting corollary can be drawn out from the utilities industry, like electricity. So in the 1800s, all the factories used to have an in-house electricity generation. But when the Edison electricity grid came out, they all went onto the grid and they gave away of their internal distribution generation.
Okay.
So this is what cloud is. So
what's a property of your utility company?
Basically, you pay as you go.
Bingo. So pay as you go. What else makes cloud unique from the normal way we use IT?
You do away with a large IT infrastructure. You don't need as many people to do the same amount of work.
And because why?
Because your infrastructure and your platform actually moves away
right from
within the confines of your industry.
And where does it go to?
So one example would be Amazon's EC2 and S3.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, you leverage essentially large providers of pooled resources as opposed to having, you know, separate. What else? What else is unique or different, or what's a property of cloud computing?
More security?
That's debatable. That's not. We can talk about that, but that's not absolute. What else?
Accessibility. I mean, since like Considering for companies, if they store their data on the cloud, you can just access your data from anywhere you want. You don't have to be on your system to.
Yeah, that is. That's a good point. I mean, that's right. Because it's on the network, you can get, as long as you can get to the network, as long as you get to the internet, you can get to the service. And then once you get to the service, what's unique about the way you interact with it? If you think about when you set up your Gmail account, which I'm sure most of you did, you know, a lot of students use Gmail. Did you call somebody? Did someone configure it for you? Did you have an IT person set it up for you? No, it's self-service. Most cloud, a good cloud service is self-service. It takes the middleman out. The IT people go away. You get access to the service and set it up yourself. And then there's one more key feature of cloud computing. It's pretty fundamental to the value proposition of cloud. All right, so right now you guys got 80%. Yes?
To handle large amounts of information.
That's very close. How does it handle large amount of information?
Efficiently.
What's that?
More efficiently.
Efficient, yep. It is more efficient because it is, think of a rubber band.
Elastic,
thank you. So, you know, if you have a service, if you have an IT capability that you get as a service, as you know was mentioned, and it has these five properties, that's cloud computing. Cloud computing is about a different way to deliver and consume IT. To many of you in this room, it's not going to seem that different because the way you live your lives today, a lot of the tools you use are already cloud, and you're saying, so what's the big deal? The big deal is it's very different from the way most companies run their IT today. And so it's causing a transformation in the industry of how efficient IT can be and then how IT can help that company differentiate itself in the marketplace. And that's really what I'm talking about today is, and this is an interesting group because you guys are technical, but you're in a business school environment, and that's what this is all about, which is cloud computing has ramifications on both the technical side and also on the way a business differentiates itself and transforms itself. The need is pretty clear. This is a very old slide. I've been using this slide since I think my autonomic computing days. And I've never changed it because, first, I can't find one that's as compelling as this. And second, the trend goes beyond this slide. If it ever changed, I would stop using the slide. This slide only goes out to 2010, but, you know, the message is pretty clear. For every dollar that's spent by IT, 70 cents or more goes towards just maintaining and managing the old stuff, and that only leaves companies 30 cents on the dollar to invest in new stuff. And that's been a problem, as you can see, for years in corporate IT. It has flattened, I will say, since 2010 because of cloud, but it's still more than you'd like. You'd like to know that if you're given a dollar to invest in IT, you can invest most of it in something new and business transforming rather than keeping, maintaining, and managing the old stuff. This problem is exacerbated by the fact that we are in a massive digitization age. More and more of our daily lives are turning into digital information. You know, it started with things as simple as email and the changes that have gone on with the postal service and, you know, what used to be all on paper is now, you know, email. But it goes way beyond that. This era of big data, of where everything creates more and more content. Every time you send a tweet, right? Every time somebody puts up a new, you know, reads a book on their Kindle. I mean, this is everything, parts of our lives. The way you consume movies, right? I mean, if you've watched the Netflix transformation, it wasn't that long ago that you still got Netflix was cool because, you know, you could actually get a CD in the mail. Today, that's the smaller part of their business. Everybody streams bits over the internet to consume content from Netflix. So this digitization makes it even a bigger problem than it's been, or a bigger challenge, I should say, because of the fact that, you know, digitization also solves, obviously, as many problems as it may create from an IT perspective. Someone earlier mentioned it's akin to the history of electricity and how, you know, you would move. People stopped generating their own electricity when utility companies could sell it to you over long distances in a pay-as-you-go model. There are other examples that I put up here just so you can get in your head, you know, what this is all about. This concept of industrialization of IT is important because, really, if you look at the demands on IT, they've hit an inflection point in the last 10 years, which is similar to transformations that forced the telephone industry. You know, the telephone industry used to be human beings in the middle of every conversation connecting, you know, operators on roller skates going up and down connecting calls. So every time someone bought a new phone, people, you know, you needed more operators. That just wasn't going to scale. And so when it hit this level of industrialization, they switched to the electronic switching network. And the car industry was the same way with, you know, the automated assembly lines. But the example I like the best is ATMs. Because the nice thing, you know, none of you remember these days, but, you know, we used to always have to get cash, we had to go to a teller. Waited in line at the bank, you know, had a withdrawal form, and you'd get cash. There was always a human being between you and your money, right? That was the way the world was. The ATM introduced the ability of self-service and automation and access anywhere in the world to, you know, banking. And that's very similar to what cloud computing does to IT, right? It introduces this ability to take the people out of the middle and you interact directly and self-serve your IT. So it's created this shift, and whenever there's a major shift in IT, there's going to be a lot of ramifications. Lots of people are going to make money, other people are going to, you know, be out of business, and that's what's happening now. Just a few examples, slides, overview slides. On cloud computing. We talk about it as a service, as was mentioned earlier, and it's really any kind of IT function as a service, and it's sort of layered out in this model of infrastructure as a service, where as opposed to buying a server or a piece of hardware, you use it over the internet, and you get a virtual server. Platform as a service, which means as opposed to buying the infrastructure or middleware you need to create applications, whether it's as a software developer or as deploying an application, that all resides for you in the cloud. Software as a service is the most common one. It's you have an application you want, and as opposed to installing it yourself, you get it delivered to you as a service. Companies, I won't give an example yet, but we can talk about some examples later. And then business process as a service, which is probably the most nascent and the one that's least understood as well. But it's really taking an application and not only getting the software as a service, but then surrounding it with people to have the whole business process delivered to you as a service. Who can give me some examples of each of these? Someone name an infrastructure as a service provider today. And it's not fair just to say IBM, IBM, IBM. So other than IBM, who... Who's an infrastructure as a service? It's already been mentioned once. Go ahead.
NetApp.
Who?
NetApp.
I'm not sure. Maybe. Who's the leader? Who's the big elephant in the room? Just shout it out. Thank you. Amazon. And what about platform as a service? Anybody know a platform as a service provider?
EMC.
Yes. EMC through the subsidiary Pivotal. I guess I would consider them a platform as a service provider. Software as a service?
Yeah. SAP.
Microsoft has a lot of, SAP has a lot of. So, you know, these are some of the big dogs in the cloud industry. Amazon from an infrastructure as a service, Google and their app engine, but Pivotal is another good example of a platform as a service. Salesforce.com is one of the biggest SaaS providers in the industry. And then, you know, Fidelity you can think of as a business process as a service provider. They essentially can run your 401k program for a company and have it be in a... It's the closest thing we have today of a good example of business process as a service. The thing about cloud is none of these things are mutually exclusive, and they all have roles. Infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service. They all have roles in what they do, but as you push more and more to the cloud, you get more standardization, lower cost, faster time to value. But you lose customization and the ability to, you know, control more. So, you know, the way we do it today, where you own all your own hardware, software, you run it inside your own data center, you have ultimate control. As you move up the stack of cloud, you lose some of that control. So you're making these trade-offs. There's been a number of announcements recently. Large companies who you know, let's see who's honest here. Who's ever played Farmville? Come on. I know there's more than one person in this room. Two people. Okay, good. Well, the honest people, you know what Farmville is, and I'm sure the rest of you do too. Farmville is a game by a company called Zynga. And Zynga recently, well, it's not recent anymore, last year they announced that they're moving off Amazon and they're going to run it themselves. They're going to run their own, they're not going to go to Amazon Cloud for their infrastructure anymore. They're going to move it in-house and run it out of their own data centers. Now, why would, if cloud is so great, why would Zynga do that? Why would they move out of the cloud, essentially?
Security concerns?
Could be, but we're talking farm bill. I don't think that was the reason. But I mean, I'm glad you are raising your people.
Probably have a cost concern with so many people using it and they having to support so many increased number of users.
Yeah, that's basically what it comes down to. They did the math, and once you reach a certain peak, once you reach a level of consumption where elasticity is not that important anymore, and you have a known quantity of how much you're, you know, you can do forecasting, smart forecasting of how much your load's going to be. You can start running at high volume. You can start running basically your own private cloud and do it at a cost that's cheaper than what an Amazon can do it at. But, you know, this is the value prop of cloud. So if you don't need those things, it's not always the best solution, right? So having that ability to customize and control still makes sense. The traditional way of doing IT is not going away. But now you have options. You have flexibility that you didn't have before. Was there a question over here?
Yeah, I was going to ask if that's the case, then why does someone like Netflix stay on Amazon services?
Yeah, so I think that's a great question. Why is Netflix still on Amazon? I don't think this is just Rick's prediction. I don't think that's going to last. The problem with Netflix is they're so big that, and they're so important from a real-time perspective, that it's probably taking them a while to recreate what Amazon does for them. But I have to believe that they're going to someday announce they're going to build a big data center and they're going to run it out of their own data centers. But, you know, I could be wrong. I mean, maybe Amazon gives them a sweetheart deal, too. You know, you just don't know the conditions of the contracts and what have you. But that's a great point. You'd think Netflix is now at a point where they could more cheaply run their own infrastructure.
How am I doing?
When I started working with people on cloud in 2009, it was all about more efficient IT, being able to run your data center more efficiently and having this flexibility. Over time, this perception of the value of cloud has been changing to one where people now see the value in what it can do for their business. We talk about this in the early days, it was about optimizing, and then it was about time to market, and cloud can help me do things quicker. You know, a typical project in corporate America, you know, let's say you're in marketing and you want to run a campaign and a promotion, and it requires, you know, some development for the web interface. It requires infrastructure, it requires programming, and you would put in a request for the project, and then you would have to get capital, and you would have to get, you know, approval of all this. And these kinds of things would take so long that sometimes they wouldn't be worth doing the promo. With cloud, a lot of companies now, you know, they can go from idea to customer facing in weeks rather than months, because the provision, the hardware in minutes, they can run the software in the cloud. It's speeded up and has made certain things that before you couldn't get a good time to value or a good ROI, a good return on investment, are now possible. Projects that companies didn't undertake 10 years ago, they're now doing with cloud. But that leads to really the really interesting thing, which is about enabling things that were not possible before. New business models, competitive advantage. So when we talk about, you know, career and, you know, career options, and you're thinking about what you're going to do with your life, you got to think about the fact that IT is going to be very different 10 years from now as it is than it is today. And it's going to make things possible, and we've already seen it in some of the examples we've already given, that wouldn't have been possible without cloud. And so thinking about, you know, if you're entrepreneurial and you're thinking of having an idea, thinking about the possibilities by leveraging this infinite elastic infrastructure certainly should be weighing in any ideas you have. So it's, you know, this is somewhat repetitive. So it's evolving, cloud is evolving from just an evolution of information technology to this enabler of business transformation. This quote up here is extremely old. But once again, I like it because I haven't found a better one. But this was a media company CIO who basically said, you know, we're spending almost all our money, 95% of the IT budget and headcount were allocated to the operations side of the business. Operations being running the stuff you've already got. By the end of the year, we want to get that figure to about 30% so we can get 70% of the budget to what's called the transformational side, which is business transformation, doing new things, creating new abilities for your company in whatever industry you happen to be in, right? Manufacturing, governments, even, you know, universities, but telecommunications, whatever industry you happen to be in, there's going to be implications and possibilities brought about by cloud computing. Feel free to interrupt me at any time if you have a question, by the way. Yes?
So, Rick, where do you see the trend? 10 years, where do you see, or where does IBM see this whole thing going?
That's a great question. I'm going to talk a little bit about the evolution of where the programming model is going to go.
Okay.
And then I'll make sure and talk to the fact that what are the implications then, you know, 10 years from now, right? Okay, so this says a recent survey. This survey actually was published yesterday. So you're getting the latest. You're getting the latest and greatest that I have to offer you. And if you want, I should have put the URL in here. It's actually in there, probably down in this little tiny print somewhere. IBM.com/IBMCAI/global cloud study. But if you go to my Twitter feed today or yesterday, I put a tweet out there that points you right to the study. It was very interesting. It was a double blind study that we had a Oxford Economics, I think was the name of the company, do it. for us, 800 decision makers of that have made decisions in their company about cloud computing. Some of them were in the line of business, the people that actually run the parts of the business that, you know, generate revenue, and some of them were in IT. About half and half, I think. I can't remember exactly how many. What was interesting is one of the questions they asked was, how important is cloud computing is to your overall business success today, and how important will it be 3 years from now? And what was interesting was the line of business, the business people see it as being extremely important to their overall business success. 72% say in 3 years it's going to be extremely important to their business success, right? Not their IT success, their business success. So they cross over. So, you know, the message here is that IT people kind of understand cloud, and so what they believe today is they sort of project it's almost flat for 3 years from now. You know, the business people see the potential of cloud, know what they're doing today, and they believe there's so much more they can do in 3 years. So if someone wearing a business hat, goes back to what I said before, you should be thinking about, you know, what are the possibilities of cloud computing? Lots of good stuff in the study. I obviously didn't want to spend the whole time just on the study, but here's one other slide from that study. It says that there are three types of people. Out of the 800 we surveyed, they broke logically into three, you know, statistically differentiated buckets. You have pacesetters, challengers, and chasers. Where pacesetters were the people who had most embraced cloud computing, not just for IT transformation, but for business transformation. Challengers had leveraged it for IT transformation, but hadn't caught up in terms of transforming their business. And chasers were just now kind of getting into cloud computing. So, you know, once we were able to sort of sort the respondents into those three buckets, then it was interesting to compare and analyze the difference in data. And what you see is the last column is the delta between pacesetters and chasers. So, for example, 136% more of the people in the pacesetter bucket said they are using cloud computing to reinvent customer relationships. You know, that's just one of the examples when we talk about business transformation. I don't know if you can read it in the back of the room, but some of the other ones are innovate products and services rapidly. You know, that's the example I gave. Building new and improved business models. Doing things they couldn't do before, essentially. The second bucket was all about better decision making. Somebody mentioned big data. You know, there's all this data out there, and it's hard to store and analyze. I mean, the amount of processing you would need statically if you were to run a big data analytics infrastructure in your company is going to grow exponentially if you had to always have enough processing power to do the analytics you want to do. But with cloud, you know, you can rent, if you will, 1,000 CPUs for overnight and have all the big data crunched and get the analytics you need real time. I talked to a movie studio, I guess I can say who it was, because it was a long time ago, Illumination, the people that did, what the heck's the name of the movie? Dang it. No one can help me here? Digital, animated movie? What's that?
What's the movie about?
I'll think of it in a minute. It's Despicable Me. And they talked about how cloud was, and this was years ago, so I haven't followed up with them, was transforming the animated movie business, because it used to be you would have so many servers inside the studio that once, you know, the creation was done, you have to rasterize and digitize that into film, and that's a compute-intensive process. So if you had 100 servers, you crank them, you digitize the movie, and it could take you 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks, whatever, to get it done. Now, once you have all the big data, essentially the creation of the film, animated film, you can do that step in the cloud and get 1,000 servers and get the movie to market, you know, months or weeks, if not months earlier than you would have otherwise. So, you know, this ability to leverage an elastic compute platform is a pretty big differentiator in a lot of industries. Deeper collaboration, being able to set up systems that are, since they're by definition cloud systems, are on the internet and they're elastic and you can have people self-serve on. A number of companies have moved to the cloud for their supply chain, for business partners, for, you know, other social relationships that they want to run through their marketing department, etc. So that gives you some examples from this survey, and there's more in there if you want to go take a look of the business value being driven and how these people who we classified as pace setters are sort of showing the way for how to differentiate your business through cloud computing. Oh man, I'm doing good. Slow down. So what's next, the question that was asked, you know, where do we see all this going? Now, remember, I've been looking through this, and I look through this working for IBM through a corporate IT lens. So, as I said at the beginning of the hour, a lot of you are saying, you know, we see this cloud stuff every day. And that's because, you know, cloud really got traction first on the consumer side of IT, not the business side. So I tell people, if you want to know what the future of your corporate IT is going to look like, just look where consumer apps are today, right? I was shocked. First of all, who can name the three examples I have up here on the board?
iCloud, Google Drive, and I don't know what about Amazon Cloud.
Very good. So, you know, these are three screenshots from iCloud from Apple, which, you know, I assume many of you, I don't know, how many are enabled, just out of curiosity, on iCloud? Yeah, that's what I figured. So, you know, it wasn't that long ago we still synced with our, you know, laptop. And, you know, I said at the time, I said, this is really kind of a screwy system where you're trying to be mobile, but yet you're still tethered if you want to get your music or, you know, back up your phone or whatever. So, you know, then iCloud came out. When I bought my Kindle, this Kindle Fire, that's the first time I had seen the word cloud in a user interface. And I was just shocked. I was already working on cloud, so, you know, I knew what cloud was. I was like, but does the average person who buys a Kindle know what cloud is? And it's right there on the user interface. You can say, I want to see my books that are on my device. Or you push a button, you say, I want to see my books that are in my cloud, right? And that was really the first time it started exposing the word cloud in, you know, to the consumer world. And now it's pretty prevalent, right? And then, as mentioned, the third one is, you know, Google Docs. A lot of people and businesses have started moving to the cloud for, you know, for word processing, spreadsheets, and those kinds of things. So, and then, of course, there's Dropbox and Box and all these other kind of cloud applications that are pervasive now in the consumer world that are making their way into businesses. We call these applications, I call these, well, I guess it's not just me, but, you know, we call these applications born on the cloud. Because if you're an application developer, I mean, a lot of you are, how many people in this room have written a line of code before? Any kind. Very good. All right. I knew it was an engineering school, but, you know, sometimes you have engineers and they're, you know, they're not quite coders. That's great. So, you know, applications going forward are going to be born on the cloud, which means if you know you're writing for the cloud, you will do things very different than the way you do applications today. You know, take something as simple as, you know, capacity management. The way typical large enterprise applications are written today is you have some way to do forecast, you know, you monitor, essentially, you put an infrastructure in to monitor utilization. And you constantly, where Latondra and I worked, the part of IBM, we had software that would do calculations of utilization and forecasting of utilization and give you a heads up when you need to put a new server into the pool, right? So that you could keep up with demand and always had some headroom between how much capacity you had online versus how much capacity was being used. And you had to write your application that way. In the cloud, you do it very differently. You write your application that once you get to capacity, you just go ahead and dynamically provision another server and add it to the pool. So, this whole idea of having to statically add, goes away. And there's lots of examples like that. But we call them born on the cloud applications because if you're writing where you know you're going to develop and deploy in the cloud, you do things very differently. My one claim to fame is that if you Google born on the cloud, the first hit is a blog I wrote several years ago on this topic, which is, the difference between born in the enterprise applications and born on the app. And I don't know who keeps Googling it that it stays at number one, or maybe it's just such a, esoteric topic or something that nobody else, but it's really what I think fundamentally how you have to think in terms of the future of applications in the enterprise. There's a couple of data points that tell you why things are different going forward. First, let's look at smart clouds and tablets versus notebook and desktop PCs. In 2010, at the end of 2010, we hit the inflection point where more smartphones and tablets were sold in the world than desktops and notebooks. And if you see the slope of the curve, and I don't even believe this desktop and notebook curve anymore. I think it's either flattened or dropped. I need to refresh this data. But that's number of sales. So if you look at the curves, it doesn't take long before the majority of devices out there that you as an application writer or you as a company are going to be supporting, the majority are going to be tablets and smartphones. So that mobility and the growth of mobile devices and the power of mobile devices, the compute power and storage in this, in an iPhone is just incredible compared to, desktops of just, not that many years ago. Here's another place where, I work in strategy now, and strategists love when you have line charts that cross. Because wherever they cross, that's something interesting. And here's another one where lines cross. This is where, I think it was about mid-2011, is where the amount of minutes, and I don't know who counts this, but the amount of minutes spent on social media, popular social media sites, was more than web portal sites. And that's significant because it says more and more of our time we want to spend in places where we can interact with other people, whether it be LinkedIn or Facebook or Twitter. We're consuming things that are not just coming from somebody who decides what news we're going to read. We are consuming things where people we know and trust are giving us things that they think would be interested in reading, right? And so that aspect of social is part of the paradigm shift. And it'll be factored in going forward in the way that you're expecting an application to work. You expect an application going forward to have the ability to plug into social networks. And it's not just social networks, but also, allow you to plug into your contacts, be able to share information easily, not make it hard for you if you are creating something in an application to be able to share it with somebody else. Because that social aspect is a big part of the future of where, IT is going. We call this SMAC. And it's, some people call it CAMS. I don't think, you know, you can come up with some other acronyms that probably aren't so good, like SCAM. I don't think that'd be a good. I don't think that'd be a good thing to call it. But I prefer SMAC just because it has that ring to it, and I tell people I like to talk smack sometimes. It's all about the aggregation of these forces of IT today coming together, you know, social, mobile, analytics, and cloud. Cloud is the delivery model. It's highly elastic. It's everywhere. It's pervasive. It can go to your mobile device. It can go to your laptop. Mobile, you know, that's how you're going to be consuming applications in the future. Analytics are sort of built into everything we do today from a consumer point of view. You don't always realize it, but every time that you, you know, use your Starbucks app or you use, you know, Facebook or whatever, somebody is saving what you did and later on is going to crunch it and learn things from it. You know? And then social, right? You talked about that, is that you expect this tight integration with either your network or some broader social network. And that's really what's powering this new class of systems. That's it. Yeah. So, key themes here. It represents a permanent shift in the way IT is delivered. Believe me, I was around in 2008 and 2009 when so many people said, oh, it's just a marketing, you know, it's just marketing hype. It's just, you know, the next thing is going to come and go. And I'm like, I'm not so sure about that. And now I think there's realization that it is as different from what we did before as, you know, mainframes were from client server. When we went to distributed computing with the advent of the PC. You know, before that, everybody had what they call dumb terminals that talked to mainframes, and that's the way you did IT. You know, it was profoundly different when the PC came about, and you had intelligence in your computer, and then you could distribute computation between what was in the back and what was in the front. You didn't have that capability before. That was pretty profound, and I think now many people are agreeing that this is just as profound of a change, of a shift from that sort of distributed and web sort of model to one of cloud computing. Two is it does bring greater efficiency and flexibility to IT. I think, you know, it is going to allow people to spend less of their money sort of maintaining the stuff they have. And allow them to shift it to some of the more interesting parts of IT, or just save money in general. But the most profound value of cloud will be the impact it will have on business innovation, and I think we talked a little bit about that. And so this next generation of born-on-the-cloud apps will be cloud-delivered, mobile by design, have integrated analytics, and then built into social networks. So, you know, those are the key messages I wanted to get across.